the word you hear that cleanses your mind. When your mind has been cleansed, your life is holy. If you are not taught who Christ is, you cannot live an effective Christian life. There is no other honor greater than that of sonship. Worldliness is the trap that enslaves men to the devil.
Relationship with God is a gift. Fellowship is a choice. The true expression of divine love is forgiveness to others. What you pursue is an expression of what you desire. To them, God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. What is the mystery? Which is Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Balatiada.
Christ in you. Hallelujah. God willed to make known to them the riches of the glory of this mystery. To lay a foundation, I'll tell you this, which I always say. The kingdom of God operates on mysteries. These mysteries cannot be discovered. They can only be revealed by the ministry of the Holy Spirit. God will to make known. You cannot discover the mystery of God. It must be revealed by the Holy Spirit to you. Are you following me here? So, you can write that down. God's kingdom operates on mysteries. But these mysteries cannot be discovered. They can only be revealed by the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Now, the reason why this thing I've said is a foundation is because for every other thing we will speak come from this point. A mystery being unveiled to us. Do you understand me? Tell somebody, the kingdom of God operates on mysteries. These mysteries cannot be discovered. They can only be revealed by the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Did you answer, Father? Thank you for revealing the mystery to me. One more time again.
Father, thank you for revealing the mystery.
Now watch this. If only the Holy Spirit can reveal the mystery of the kingdom, it means when you neglect fellowship with the Holy Spirit, you have unconsciously denied yourself access to the deep things of God. Christians who don't pray, who don't study the scripture, who think that Christianity is all about coming to church on Sunday and clapping their hands, they will never experience the fullness of God. They will not experience the best of God. Whenever you neglect fellowship with the Holy Spirit, you have unconsciously denied yourself from having access to the deep things of God. There is nothing as important in Christianity as the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit. He said, when the Holy Spirit shall come, he will guide you into all truth. He will teach you all things, guide you into all truth, and teach you all things. So when a Christian does not want to have anything to do with the Holy Spirit, all they want to do is with their pastor, they may never ever be able to have access to the deep things of God. So if God give you pastors as we are here, our assignment is to open your eyes to the deep things of the scripture to prompt you into fellowship with the Holy Spirit. No matter what I teach, no matter what I preach, until you yourself begin to have fellowship with the Holy Spirit, you will not walk in the experience of God. So you must have fellowship. You must have, not me, must. You must not neglect it. You must not just come to church now and copy what I'm preaching and clap and dance. You must go back and sit down and spend time with the Holy Spirit. If not, all we are preaching will just be a message and will never become a reality. He said, God has willed to make known this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So it is a mystery. It is a mystery. Until the mysteries of the kingdom are revealed to us, we can never experience the blessings of the kingdom. We will just keep coming to church and we'll be confessing, I am blessed, I am healed, I am delivered, but we will still be in bondage until we have understood the deep things. things of God. Friends, don't be deceived. You see this book? It's not simple at all. It's not simple at all. Bible says, for all scripture was written by the inspiration of God. Now, if the scriptures were written by the inspiration of the Spirit, they can only be understood by the inspiration of the Spirit. It's like when the Lord Jesus says, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. What does he mean? If you take it like that, all of us will be a paralyzed church. Everybody here will have one hand or one leg. But what, you can only understand what he said there by the Holy Spirit. That is why you cannot neglect fellowship with the Holy Spirit. So the Lord begins to speak, then he says, he has made known to us this mystery, which is Christ in us, the Christ in you, the hope of glory. The hope. Let me say this to you. No matter what you are going through, it is your consciousness of the presence of Christ in you that will turn it for your good. Christ can be in you. But if you are not conscious that he is in you, then what you are going through cannot be turned around for your good. You must be conscious. You must be obsessed. You must be possessed with the knowledge that Christ is in me. Christ in you, the hope of glory. It does not matter what you are going through now. It does not matter what has happened to you. If Christ is in you, he said, you can hope for glory. Friends, there is nothing as hopelessness or helplessness when Christ is involved. There is nothing too scattered that God cannot gather. There is nothing too broken that God cannot repair. There is nothing too destroyed that God cannot restore. If you can check the scriptures and you see the account of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, everywhere he entered, he turned the way around. He came to the house of Jairus' daughter, was dead. He entered there, joy came. There is nowhere that Christ has entered and he didn't bear the fruits of joy. Ladies and gentlemen, righteousness, peace, and joy are the fruits of the presence of Christ in you. If Christ be in you, sickness is not the fruit. Poverty is not the fruit. Rejection is not the fruit. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink. It is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is the Spirit of Christ. So righteousness, peace, and joy are the fruits of the acknowledgement of the presence of Christ in us. So Christ can be in you, but because you don't acknowledge it, you're acknowledging failure, you see nothing. In this kingdom where we operate, everything works by acknowledgement. You hear your talk? There is a difference between knowledge and acknowledge. Knowledge means to know. Acknowledge means to accept, to confess, to walk by it. He says, do you believe there is God? He says, even the devil believe. So believing that God exists is no news. The real deal is believing what God has said. You believe that there is one God, you do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. I'm going to show something here. I'm talking about Christ in you. So everybody believe that God exists. Every religion, they believe God exists. That's why they have a religion. They believe there is a God. They pray to a God or God, whoever they pray to. But Christianity is the only religion where the God we serve does not only dwell in heaven, neither is he only read in a book, but he equally dwells in the heart of those that believe in him. There is no religion that is bold to claim that God is in them. Matter of fact, Jesus died because he claimed unity with God. Jesus was killed because he said, I am. The Pharisees said, how can you say you are the Son of God? Are you crazy? Do you mean you are one with God? They did not understand what he came to bring. Do you know the gospel of Christ? This is the gospel that the righteous people by the flesh cannot accept. But it is a gospel that prostitutes will accept. Yes, because it appeals to them. It tells them that Christ died for you And because of his death for you, you have been justified. Ah, Pharisees say, no, it cannot happen. Sir, this woman was caught in adultery. She has to be stoned. They could not believe, they could not accept that they did not understand the mystery of the death of Christ. Not knowing that the death of Christ on the cross was the declaration of God's love to man. For God so loved the world that he sang a song. He made an album. He gave his son. So when you see the death of Christ, it is actually an expression of God's love for us. Let me say this to you. The measurement of God's love to you is not by the material things you possess in Christ. Material things is not a proof of divine love. Stop thinking that God loves your neighbor more than you because your neighbor is married and you are not married. Because your neighbor came and testified that this happened and you didn't testify. That is not a proof of divine love. The proof that God loves you is that Jesus died for you. God loves us. He loves every one of us. I said the Lord loves you. Amen. God loves you. Amen. Don't only say amen. Do you love yourself? So watch. The main place of contention is in one thing. Who is the Christ? That's where there is argument. Who is the Christ? When Jesus came, what was the fight? They even asked John the Baptist, are you the Christ? They were looking for the Christ. When Peter saw Andrew, he said, they went and called for his brother. He said, we have found the Christ. It means they were searching for the Christ. Why? Because it had been prophesied that the Christ will come. So they were searching for the Christ. And they said, this is him. John said, this is the Christ. One day Jesus was walking. He said, who do people say I am? And disciples, they say, some say you are Jeremiah. Disciples of Christ, some say you are Jeremiah. No, sir. Some say you are Elijah. They said, who do you say I am? No answer. Listen. When you derive your knowledge of God from the opinions of men, it cannot stand the test of trials. If what you know of God is what somebody told you, you will fall. They that do know, does it know God or their God? That is a relationship. Their is a noun, a pronoun that speaks of what? Relationship. My dear God that have a relationship with him, they shall be strong. Who do the people say? So people can describe God according to what Prophet Kevin preached. Then Jesus said, okay, who do you say I am? Eh? You are the God of Papa now, the God of Prophet Kevin. No, who do you say I am? You are the lily in the valley. Who do you say I am? You are the Jehovah the locator now. Who do you say I am? That's what Kevin said. Who do you say I am? Who do you say I am? Who do you say I am? Then Simon turned and said, you are the Christ. Ah! Then Jesus said, hey, Simon, flesh. He said, blessed are thou. You see our trouble today. Allah Bakena. We think that when they say a man is blessed, it must be demonstrated in the presence of material things. But he called Peter blessed because Peter knew him as the Christ. So the true blessing is to have the revelation and the relationship with Christ, not a car. People can have a car without knowing him. Oh, Manda Kappa. People can get married without knowing him. But nobody can know him without fellowship with him. That is the blessing. When we say you are blessed, your mind will just tell you, you are blessed means you are going to have a car. When I say you are blessed, I'm saying you have been granted privilege to know God. But we don't want that one. We want the blessing that is material. So there must be a car. There must be, if it is the people who prosper in the world, who bless them for them to have those things they have. If that is all what is blessing, if blessing only bring car, all these unbelievers that have cars, they have it by which blessing? Therefore, if you are praying and fasting to have what unbelievers have, and they even mock at your God, plus you, plus your church, plus your pastor, and nothing happens to them, you have not yet understood that there's something you have they don't have. What do you have? Christ in me. Christ in me. I'd like you to understand today, the greatest honor that God can give to a man is to release Christ to dwell in his heart. There is nothing greater than that. There is nothing you should look for. There is nothing better or bigger than Christ dwelling in you. Christ did not dwell in the people of old. Great prophets like Isaiah, great prophets like Elijah, Samuel, they look up to the day when Christ will come. They prophesied it, and we experience it. That's what even Jesus said. He said, for all born of a woman, John the Baptist is the greatest. He said, but the least in the kingdom is greater than John. That's why we can't pray to the God of Elijah. It is the same God though. But Christ was not in Elijah. He had the anointing on him. When Kevin shows up and they ask Kevin, what is your greatest asset? What is your greatest inheritance? And I'll reply, Christ in me. I will not reply, I have two cars, I have a house, I have all those things are vanity. All those things are vanity. Your greatest asset as a Christian is the presence of Christ in you. That is your hope of glory. That is your confidence. That is your assurance that you have been sealed and preserved to partake of the glory of heaven. Christ in you. Now watch this. He says, what the people say, and Peter says, hey, you are the Christ. Balabaka, you are the Christ. He said, blessed are you, Simon. Flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but the Spirit of my Father. I tell you the truth. You are Simon, but you are Peter. His father gave it to him, called him Simon. He lived as Simon for more than 50 years. The day it was revealed to him who Christ was is the day he discovered himself. Why? Your true identity is hidden in the identity of Christ. If you don't know him, you don't know yourself. As he is, so are we. The reason why you are going through failure is because you are seeing yourself in the eyes of what your father says you are. You are seeing yourself in the eyes of who society says you are. People have somebody wrote exam 4 times and failed, and they called him a failure. And I said, you are not a failure. It is society that has put a standard that if you do not pass GCE, you have become a failure. That is their standard. Joseph did not have GCE. That's a human standard. Every time you look at yourself by the eyes of the flesh, you will see your weakness. But when you look at yourself by the eyes of the Spirit, you will see the strength of Christ in you. Which one are you looking at? Are you Simon or are you Peter? Is he Abraham or is he Abraham? Is he Jacob or is he Israel? Why does he keep changing their names? He said, I tell you the truth. Because you know who I am, I will tell you who you are. I am the vine, you are the branch. Every time Christ said who he was, he now said who you were because of who he was. I am the vine, you are the branch. You are the Christ, you are Peter. I am Elohim, you are Abraham. You are still fighting to know yourself because you have not accepted to know him. You don't want to know him. You are only after what he can give you. You don't want to know him. Friends, on this earth realm, the center, the greatest force on earth is called gravity. Every other law on this earth realm is subject to gravity. No law supersedes it. No law. In the kingdom of God, the greatest law, the greatest force is Christ. In fact, show me Colossians chapter 1 verse 16. For by him were all things created. Stop. By who? Are these people hearing me? Can we read again? For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominion or principality or power. all things were created by him and for him. Verse 17. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. Please, can you read it from your Bible? Let's take it again, verse 16. For by him were all things created, that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominion or principalities or powers or things. All things were created by him and for him. Stop there. I'll go to the next verse. Watch. He said, by him were all things created, that are in heaven or in the earth, visible or invisible. Wait. Whether there be thrones, powers, principalities, all things were created by him and for him. That devil you are afraid of, he was created by him and for him. That principality over the nation was Alabakamasia. Do you understand that the person who created what you are afraid of is inside of you? Hey. Whether there be witches, Alakabagia. Whether there be principalities or powers or thrones, all things were created by him, whether visible or invisible. Now he said they were created by him and for him. In other words, whether they like it or not, they must serve him. They were created by him and for him. So the devil was created by who? So Christ is in you, and you are running from something that Christ created, but he's in you. Bible says when the Lord Jesus entered the temple to preach, he said the demons began to cry out. He said, what have we done to you? Have you come to torment us? In other words, the presence of Christ in you is what makes your presence to torment devils in an environment. When Allah back, you know, they fear you. They fear you. If they know be the fear, they know they can't attack you, say, I dream. They fear you. And the greatest attack of the devil is that you should not know who you are. He said, for this purpose, the devil has blinded their eye so that they will not see the light in the gospel. So though they will hear us preach, they will still go by thinking they are failures. They will not see the light of the gospel. Christ in me. Why then should I run for what Christ created? I prophesy. See that by the presence of Christ in you, and by this knowledge and this acknowledgement, everywhere you enter, I decree that demons will step out.
Amen.
Let your amen be louder.
Amen.
Someone say, Christ in me.
Christ in me.
The hope of glory.
The hope of glory.
Take note of what I said. Write this down. It is the presence of Christ in you that makes your presence uncomfortable for demons to abide in. When we come somewhere, because Christ is in us, demons can't stay there. They can't feel, in fact, even if they try to stay, they can't be comfortable because our presence torments them. You know, as I'm preaching now, it is hard to accept it. Because you have been taught to believe Satan is so powerful. So, but I'm telling you now that yes, I agree he's powerful. But I'm saying that the one that gave him that power is living inside of you. This should make you change the way you walk, change the way you talk. If this understanding will change your confidence, there are certain things that I cannot say. A witch will kill me. How? I don't understand. How did they do? Like, how? Are they flying? How high can they fly that they can't be arrested? Is it inside the water? David said, even if I go to hell, darkness is like light to you. He said, where shall I run from him? Where can they hide? God sent Jonah. Jonah said, let me run. You want to run from God? God said, young man, be very careful, eh? The next thing, storm. Jonah entered water. God sent fish. Even in the fish, he was in there. You know why God sent the fish? Because when Jonah was in the boat, he didn't want to pray. God said, okay, you don't want to pray. You will pray. in the boat, everybody was praying, Jonah was sleeping. When the fish came, when Jonah entered the fish belly, he now prayed. What am I trying to say? There are times that God allows certain harsh circumstances to come to you so he can push you to come closer to him. God can allow the devil to attack you. I'm trying to say this, that he has created all these things. Sometimes it seems as if there is a match, Satan is winning. Sometimes it seems as though, when you look at your life, it's like Satan has done. That's what it seems. But listen to me, the devil could not attack Job without the permission of Yahweh. In fact, God gave him a verdict. God said, go and touch Job, but don't touch him. Did Satan kill Job? It's not because he could not kill Job, it's because God gave him a limit. Satan is a very obedient devil. No, why did he not disobey? He should have tried. God said, as you go, touch everything. Don't touch the man. He went and touched everything. Kill his children. He came back second time. God said, okay, touch his body. Don't touch his soul. Satan obeyed. He said, yes, sir. So, God can allow certain conditions happen to you, not because he wants to kill you, but because he wants to draw you closer to himself. Listen to me, God's voice can be heard through the circumstances of life. So, do not look at what you are going through as something that came to kill you. Bible says, no temptation has taken you unless God is faithful. He cannot allow you to be tempted beyond your capacity to bear. 1 Corinthians 10:13. It says, God is faithful and he will not allow you to be tempted beyond your capacity to bear. In other words, no matter what you are going through, God has placed a strength in you to bear it. And I prophesy, nothing will bring it down in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able to bear. Stop there. He will not allow you to be tempted. It means whatever has come to you, you are able to bear. Say, neighbor, sometimes God allows harsh conditions to come your way so that he can draw you to himself. That's all. If Jonah had prayed in the boat, God would not put him inside a fish. God does not like what to do. God just did that because Jonah was deaf to his voice. Jonah hardened his heart. He said, okay, since you don't want to hear me talk, you are going to hear the storm. If you don't hear the storm, you will hear the fish. One way, you will hear the voice. I prophesy, we receive the spirit of obedience to God. Amen. Let your amen be louder.
Amen.
All things were made by him and for him. And if he is in you, then all things are made for you because he is you. Say, I'm blessed. Say, I'm favored. Say, I'm lifted. Okay. Say, I am anointed.
I am anointed.
Say, I cannot see shame.
I cannot see shame.
I cannot be disgraced.
I cannot be disgraced.
Christ in me.
Christ in me.
The hope of glory.
The hope of glory.
Now, let me show you some things. All right. So, Christ is in us. Eh? What then should we do? Number one, we should be conscious of his presence in us. Philemon chapter 1, verse 6. That the sharing of your faith may become effective by the acknowledgement of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. Look here. Watch. That the sharing of your faith may become what? Effective by the acknowledgement. By the acknowledgement. Bible says in Proverbs 3 from verse 3, it says, lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge the Lord and he shall direct you. And he shall do what? He will do what? He will do what? He will do what? Many of us will lean on our understanding. When I'm preaching to you that Christ is in you, your understanding will tell you, how can Christ be in you? How can Christ be in you and you are sick? That's your understanding. Lean on what God has said, not on how you feel. Lean on what God has said. It is God's word that is the truth, not your feeling. Your feeling is not the truth. A medical report is a fact. The truth is Christ. I am the way, the truth, not a truth, the truth and the life. So you must acknowledge. Listen to me. You must acknowledge. When I speak of acknowledgement, it means you must be conscious. Friends, the silence of God is not the absence of God. It is your consciousness of the presence of Christ in you that gives you confidence even when he is silent. God must not talk for you to know he is there. What are you acknowledging? What are you conscious of? What are you conscious of? What are you looking for in life? Our confessions are our acknowledgments. He said, you are no longer Simon, you are Peter. Acknowledge this is who you are in me. Acknowledge this is what you have been made in me. What is your acknowledgement? When you go about, what do you say of yourself? How conscious are you? You know something? Many of us, we just feel the presence of God when we are in church. That's why... That's why it is very easy to worship when we come in church. Not up to 90% of people, 10%, yeah. They don't worship at home. You know why? Because when we gather like this, there is an anointing that makes them feel Jesus, and they worship, and they cry, and they pray, and they feel the Lord God so much as they leave church and they go. Friend, a woman said, Jesus, the Samaritans say we have to worship on the mountain. And the Jews say, you ought to worship in Jerusalem. And Jesus said, Madam, the time has come where the true worshippers will not worship God on this mountain, on Jerusalem, but in spirit and in truth. True worship is not tied to a place. It's tied to a person. If your worship to God is tied to a place, you don't have fellowship with him. It must be tied to a person. In other words, when listen to me, it is not Kevin that brings Jesus to church. Christ is in you. As you came, he came with you. Now, as you go back, he's also going with you. So it is very stupid to give yourself to worship to God in a gathering and not go back and worship him. But people whose worship is tied to a place, they feel holy when they're in church. They feel prayerful. If, listen to me, let me talk to you. If you only feel the presence of God when you're in church, it is a sign that you don't know God at all. That you come to church and you begin to shiver. No, you should have that understanding. Though in this gathering, you may have the feeling. When you leave, you have the person. In your room, he's in you. So if your worship is only tied to this place, it means you don't know him at all. You should worship him everywhere. Because worshiping him is not a matter of the place. It's a matter of acknowledging his presence in your heart because he's there. He said, woman, all this your worship that you have to travel for 15 meters, kilometers to come to a place and bow down. You see, it has ended. Say, from now, when the Spirit comes, even in your kitchen, for you are glorious and worthy to be praised. You are the Lamb upon the throne. And all to you I lift my voice to say, you are the Lamb upon the throne. You are in your toilet. You are in the garage. You are in the farm. The Lord is good. I will lift him up higher. Listen. Everywhere I go, I will lift him up. Did you hear what he said? Everywhere. How can you be for 1 week you don't worship? Then when you come here, you start crying. You are still in the flesh. Any cry you cry here that you didn't cry in the secret place is fake. It is emotional. It is you are acting drama. If it is a true cry, in fact, true tears are poured out in the secret place. Coming to cry that we should see you, it doesn't move God. That doesn't move us because we know better. How many people stay in the room? Thank you for saving me. Why is it only in church? How many of you sit in your room and you dance? But if you should come and show us dancing style here, you will dance. How many of you enter your room and you close your door? The things that are impossible, things that money cannot buy. And you begin to dance alone. You are highly lifted up. Alone. Abasi, I mean alone. No. Because you are conscious. Abasi, my God is so good. You are, but since you are not conscious of Him, most people only gain consciousness of God when they enter church. They enter. Ma, off my phone. God gave a church. Look at them. Listen to me. Hear me very well. If there is a kind of dress you cannot wear to church, you should not wear it and go anywhere. Because God does not dwell in the church. He dwells in you. So if there is a kind of dress you cannot wear and come here, don't wear it and go and see your friend. It means the dress is wrong. But when you are only conscious of the house, you limit your fellowship to the house. Oh God, may we break out from religion and enter relationship. Friend, what are you conscious of? What are you mindful of? Let me tell you something here. The consciousness of Christ provokes the experience of righteousness. The consciousness of sin provokes the experience of the curse. I will explain that. When you are conscious of Christ, you know what happens to you? Righteousness. But when you are conscious of sin, I am a poor sinner. Look at a stupid song. You and you are dancing. Brothers, do you know? In fact, you're telling brothers, do you know? I am a poor. I am. God said to Moses, I am that I am. The first I am is Him. The second I am is me. So if I say I am a poor, I'm saying God is a poor sinner. Not even a sinner, a poor one. Why do you want to be a poor one? There are even rich ones. Your own is a sinner and a poor one. I am a poor sinner. Then again, struggling for repentance. Struggling for repentance. You have not repented. He's struggling to repent. The song is wrong in every dimension. Number one, he's a sinner. Number two, he's a poor one. Number three, he's struggling to repent. Number four, he's dancing. Brother, do you? I am a poor. For offering time, Tina. Bobbing for repent. Oh, do you know I am a poor sinner? I'm a poor sinner. Are you a dancer that's a poor sinner? Hey, God help us. Don't be Ayabaka. Listen to me. The consciousness of sin brings guilt conscience. Guilt. Listen to me. Can I talk to you? Look at this. Listen to me. No matter how you try to be perfect before the Lord, sometimes beyond yourself you will make some mistakes. But your mistakes are a sign that you need God the more. If you are perfect, you don't need God because He's a helper. He helps you. Watch this. You may be saying, I will not fornicate. It may happen that you fornicate. It may not be your wish. There are many of us who are trying very hard not to do certain things, and we do them. Watch this. Once you commit a sin, then comes the devil. You, sinner. He starts there. Next thing he tells you, you see you? God is angry with you. He's lying. The 13, he tells you, you are unworthy of God's blessing. Watch the lies of the devil. Every time you are conscious of sin, the next thing is you'll be tormented by guilty conscience. Then you will start feeling that God hates you. You will even hear the voice. Satan will tell like God, you sinner, fornicator. I'm angry with you. You think it's God talking? Why pray? God is angry with me. He's lying. He's lying to you. If you make mistake and sin now, in the next minute, don't even harbor guilty conscience. As you wake up, ask for mercy and pray for strength to be better. If you ever allow yourself to be entangled by guilty conscience, you become a slave to your past and your sins. There are many things we have done we are not proud of. We better move ahead and do things we will be proud of. But Satan wants to keep you in those things, conscious of sin, not conscious of Christ, conscious of sin, conscious of God. So you see, you did abortion, you will never have a child. That's why you're suffering like this, because of that abortion you did in 1982. That's the voice of Satan. Next thing will tell you, you are unworthy of God's love. What a lie. Friends, let me talk to you here. If somebody fornicates, I go and fast 3 days, he's a deceiver. That fasting he fasted is to feel good, because the price of the forgiveness of God is not the efforts of man, it's the death of Christ on the cross. The price of the forgiveness of God is not the effort of man, but the blood of Christ shed on the cross. In other words, God forgives you because Jesus died for you. There is no fasting, there is no prayer you can pray. When we pray to receive forgiveness, because God has given it because of Christ. I'm not saying you should sin. No, if you sin, then you will die. I'm saying he that lives according to the flesh will die. But I'm saying this, there is no time to abide there. Sometimes you try not to be bitter. You try not to complain. It happens, you complain. Satan wants to entangle you. Reject it. I have made a mistake. Acknowledge it. He that covers his sin will not prosper. But he that forsakes it will have mercy. Lord, I have fornicated. I am sorry, Lord. Strengthen me and you move ahead. There is no time to sit down lamenting. I am a fornicator. I did abortion. When you do like that, you are still sitting in the valley of the shadow of death. Don't do that. Don't allow the devil torment your spirit with your mistakes. Don't allow him torment your heart with the things you did in the past. Listen to what I'm telling you. Now, you see this gospel now? This is what people cannot accept. A woman was caught in adultery, and the law of Moses says, stone her. Manda kebaya. Stone her. And they brought her to Jesus, ready to be stoned. And Jesus said, there's another law. He who has not sinned should be the one to stone. He said, if you have not sinned, cast a stone. He said, and everybody left. One person remained. Who? Jesus. Why? Because Jesus is the only one that has not sinned. So among all of them, Jesus was the only one legally empowered to stone the woman. Then he looked at the woman, because the same judge that can condemn you is the same one that can set you free. He looked at the woman and said, woman, go. Wait, just like that? That's a problem. Go. She didn't even say, I'm sorry. Go. Just, you see why you cannot receive the gospel? Because you always want to, you want to do something. No, you want to fast and cry, forgive me, Lord. Forgive me, Lord. I am sorry. Look at what religion has done to you. Religion. Go. Just like that. That is why people, that's why righteous in Pharisees cannot receive the gospel. Just like that. Go. The woman was going, go, go. Sir, I fornicated. I say go. I stole. Go. Only law. Go and sin no more. Watch this. Why? It may be free for her, but it costed him his blood. Do you understand what God is saying? People are so conscious of their past, conscious of their errors. No, be conscious of Christ. Be conscious of him, not of what you see. Oh, brother, he's kabalahande. Now, watch me, watch me. That's why, you know, good people, they will go to hell. Mm-hmm. Acts chapter 10, he said, there was a certain man, a good man, called Cornelius. He said, he gave gift to the poor and gave offering to God. And he prayed 3 times a day. Then an angel said, Cornelius, call for Peter to tell you words by which you will be saved. It means a man is not saved by his good works. He is saved by the sacrifice of Christ. You cannot, matter of fact, God talks here. He said your righteousness is like a menstrual pad. No, the word is, it fitted like that, is menstrual pad. That's what he said there. He said, when you come and stand and say, I pray, I fast, I give money to the church, God says, shift. Your own righteousness, your good works is not enough to qualify you. It's not enough. So why not base on his own? Why not understand that you have sinned? You have done abortion, you have fornicated. But because Christ is in you, he justifies you. He sanctifies you and he glorifies you. That's the problem now. Your heart is just like that. Yes. Because he died. Man of God, do you know what I have done? That's the problem. I don't need to know what you have done. I need to know what he did, not what you did. Because all of us have done things. But what you have done is not the problem. It's what he has done that matter. You know, in the days of Moses, when you commit a sin, you have to give an animal. So the people were, they knew that you must sow seed. You must give any sacrifice. So I have to give sacrifice. I want God to give me a child. I'll give my seed of 2 million. It's a lie. L-I-E, a lie. Your sacrifice is a testimony of your faith. You cannot make God give you anything. Anything that God will give you now because Jesus died for you. Show me Romans 8:32. He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also do what? Can you read that word there? Free. Give us how many things? Is a child there? Is a husband there? Is a job there? This is a freely. So you give sacrifice, you give seed. All these things we give are testimonies of our faith. God gives you because of his son Jesus. Whatever you ask the Father in my name, not in your seed, not in your sacrifice, in my name, he will give you because he loves me and he loves you too. So we give up. That's why people are bringing offering. Nothing is happening because they know they are bringing their offering and sacrifice, and they are coming before God with the righteousness of their offering. They are trying to lay demand on the blessing, standing on their work. And God says it doesn't work like that. If no matter, bring 20 million. Matter of fact, if you are giving to the church, it must be an expression of your love for God and thanksgiving. It is if you are giving because you want to give to God, so he can give you a child. You may give to God and he does not give you a child, or he may give you and you will not receive. If you must receive from God, you must approach him entirely depending on the sacrifice of Christ. You hear? Change your mindset. Change your mindset. You only want to do something. Change your mindset. Friends, we will give for Christ. We give because we love. I will give billions me for this gospel. But I will never give to God so that he can give me something. If we place a price tag on any miracle, that is not of God. Because he shall freely give us all things. I cannot say, man, that shake. You hear it at all? Freely. He who gave you his son. Do you think it's a husband he will not give you? Do you think it's a child? Do you understand what God is saying? He said, if God did not spare his son, how dare you think God does not want to give me a child? Bible says you are stupid. If God has given you the better, what is the good? If God did not spare his son and give him for you, he now asks, how will he not also together with his son? It means when he gave his son, he gave you all things. So if Christ be in you, you have been empowered by God to possess all things. Why are you thinking that God does not want to give you a job? Why do you think like that? Because you have been deceived by the devil. God is angry with you. God angry with you. You look at your head. You. God is angry with you. Some people even give such prophecies. Those are prophecies born of observation, not divine inspiration. My daughter, God is angry with you. Lie. God cannot be angry with her because the anger of God was poured on Christ on the cross. Even the prostitute, God is not angry with her. Bible says God wants all men to be saved. Even that your uncle is a witch that you are trying to kill. Somebody be conscious of Christ. Now, listen. Hey, can I tell something to you? If you are conscious of what you lack, it will create worry. If you are conscious of evil, it will create fear. If you are conscious of the offenses of people, it will create bitterness. If you are conscious of your achievement, it will create pride. If you are conscious of sin, it will create guilt. If you are conscious of Christ, it creates rest. Which one do you choose? Choose wisely. I should take them back again. if you are conscious of what you lack, it will create worry. If you are conscious of evil, it will create fear. If you are conscious of the offenses of others to you, it will create bitterness. If you are conscious of your achievement, it will create pride. If you are conscious of sin, it will create guilt. If you are conscious of Christ, it creates rest. Those who know that Christ is with them, Baladiga Zahada, in the midst of the storm, people are shaking. They know, I know my Redeemer lives. I know it's not far from here. I know when he will arise, the one we know, my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives. I know it's not far from me. I know when he will arise, the one we know,
the my Redeemer lives.
You are always there for me. You are always there for me. When no one else is there,
when no one else is there,
you are always there for me. There is nothing in this world that can take your place,
that can take your place in my life.
No matter what comes my way, you are always there for me. There is nothing in this world that can take your place in my life. No matter what comes my way, you are always there for me.
You are always there.
Sit down. Listen to me, child of God. There are times, Balabando Hukia, you enter a situation. Every physical option is finished. Wisdom finish. Wisdom will fail. Human connection will fail. Physical option will fail. But Christ will prevail. When you get into a situation and you look around you, there is no help. That is your mistake. Start looking inside of you. Do you think that God came and saved you and to allow you be eaten by witchcraft anyhow? That's an irresponsible God. Do you think God does not care for you? There are times you enter a condition and you look left and right. Because you keep looking left and right, that's why you don't see help. The psalmist says, I will look upon the hills, from where cometh my help. He didn't say his help coming from the hill. It was a question. I will look upon the hills, from where cometh my help? ? He now replied, my help does not come from the hill. It comes from, let's see, Psalm 121. See that? I will lift my eyes to the hills, from where cometh my, do you see a question mark there? It's a question. Verse 2 now. My help comes from the Lord. So his help does not come from the hill, but he lifted his head to the hill. See the mistake? I shall lift my head to my pastor. I shall lift my head to my bank account. But from where come my help? No matter what comes my way, you are always there for me. There is nothing in this world that can take your place in my life. No matter what comes my way, you are always there for me. You are always there for me. Lagabata, you are always there for me. Shalabate Motia,
no matter what comes my way,
you are
better for me. Iyabade, there is nothing in this world that can take your place in my life. No matter what comes my way,
no matter what comes my way,
you are always there.
You are always there for me.
See that? Ligabanda shabada. Endos kapalega badiga. I am not helpless. Say, Christ is in me. I am not hopeless. Christ is in me. I am not helpless. You have depended so much on your pastor. Depended so much on your husband. Depended so much on your brother, and they have all failed you. And you will not learn. You still carry pictures every day in the service. When God pray for this, my uncle, since he's abroad, he has not helped us. That's why he will never help you. Because God resists the proud. And what is pride? Seeking help out of God. He said, and Asa was sick, King Asa. And he did not seek help from God, so God killed him. He was sick. He said, he sought help only from the doctor and not from God. God got angry. God killed a man for going to hospital. God said, because you have gone to hospital but you did not pray first, you will die. God Almighty, no matter what comes my way, you are always there for me. There is nothing in this world that can take your place in my life.
No matter what comes my way, you are always there for me.
In Jesus' name. Liga banda manda 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 manda. To be conscious of Christ means to be spiritually minded. He said to be carnally minded is death. Is what? Death. Romans 8 chapter 5 and verse 6 is death. Only minded of the things of your flesh, of food, money. He said you will die. To be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded, it means to be conscious of Christ. There is why there is so much absence of contentment in Christianity. Is because people are not spiritually minded. They have Christ, they are not contented. Friend, if your joy is dependent on the things of the world, then grace shall be your sorrow. Because these things, they come as they go. Nothing is sure in this world. Not in this world. Nothing is sure. Nothing. No one. There is nothing you have that cannot be taken. Nothing is sure. Only Christ in you. That's the only thing. No contentment. Christians are complaining because they are not contented, not knowing. Godliness is not a means to gain. Listen to me. There is a demonic gospel. The gospel of the world is the one that presents godliness as a means to gain. If you need a child, enter department and serve. He says, 1 Timothy 6 verse 5 and 8 to 8. He said, godliness is not a means to gain. But this is how they present it. Come and serve God and God will give you a job. No, serve God because you love him. Don't serve God. Don't take godliness as a means to material gain. He said, but godliness with contentment is great gain. What a disgrace for a Christian to have Christ in him and he complains everywhere he goes. And God begins to say, I've given you Christ and you are angry because you don't have a car. Do you even weigh your complaints when you talk? Please weigh your complaint with your inheritance and see how your complaint is weightless. With what you have in you, you have the hope of glory. So there is no reason for me to complain for what I don't have now, because there is someone in me that tells me that tomorrow will be glorious. But they complain. They don't know that godliness is not a means to gain. So when they come to church and they don't have a husband, they join church very fast because they thought that godliness was a means to gain. They came to church, they stopped smoking, they stopped drinking because they wanted their business to prosper. When their business does not prosper, they leave. They say, grace is not working for me. Look at the stupidity. They don't understand that when we speak of grace working for a person, listen to me, my dear people. The grace of God is not measured by the increase in material things. It is measured by the Christ-likeness of your character. There are many of you here who are saying that grace is not working for you, because you see other people testify that I prayed for them and they had the job, I prayed for them, they had money, they had millions, and you think that grace is not working. But you don't understand that the fact that they had money is not grace. How do you know that grace is working for you? Before I came to church, I used to fornicate. I no longer fornicate. Grace is working. I used to lie. I no longer lie. Grace is working. Before it was hard for me to forgive. Now it is easy. Grace is working. That people begin to quantify grace by material things. It's not so. Grace is working for you. Can't you see the change in your character? Who told you that grace was a means to have money? No. He says sin will not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, you are under grace. So what does grace do? It empowers you to resist the desires of sin and walk in righteousness. Romans 5:17. They that have received the abundance of the grace of God and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life. They have received grace and righteousness, they shall reign. They will not be given to sin. How do I know that grace is working for you? I see you walking in holiness. Stop saying that grace is not working for you because you have a car. In fact, if you claim that grace is not working for you because you are not married, that's your unbeliever friend that married. Which grace work for her? All these Muslims that are getting billions, what grace is working for them? And we know that God does not bless sinners. We know Psalm 5:12, thou shalt surround the righteous and you will bless him, the righteous, not the unbeliever. So what is working for them? If you claim that grace is not working for you, don't you know that by saying that, by that confession, you have unconsciously denied yourself the grace of God? Know that you are backsliding back into sin. The same weakness you are conquered, it is conquering you back. Why? Because you open your mouth and you declare, grace is not working for me. Because you think that grace working means you have a job. Friends, there are people you envy in the church and you are better than them in the eyes of God. Grace is not working. Yeah, grace is not working for me. Can't you see how you have changed? Can't you see? Can't you see that something is happening in your spirit? Paul said, Timothy, he said, stand strong in the grace. Stand strong in the grace. What does it mean? Take advantage of the grace. Galatians 5:1, he said, do not allow yourself to be entangled. In other words, because there is none grace, do not allow a curse to tie you down. I don't care the cost in my family, it cannot tie me down. Because I am now under grace, I can now pray. I have an advantage. Take advantage of grace and fulfill destiny. Take advantage of grace and walk with God. Grace is not all about having money. All these people that have money, who gave to them when they don't have grace? Will your eyes not finally get opened? You only want me to preach to you and collect your money in the name of seed, and you don't see your life is not changing? You only want a gospel of promises. You will marry, and you come and sow seed. How has he helped you? Don't you understand that the true desire of God is that we should become like Christ? As many as he foreknew, he predestined. As many as he predestined, that they may be conformed to the image of his son. God wants your character to be an expression of Christ. Stop saying grace is not working for you. Do you drink like before? Do you think God is working in you? Before you were caught up in pornography, it has ended. Look at the many things that you have stopped doing. You think you stopped it by your power? Friend, there is no strength in man to resist sin. Only grace can help. Stop saying that grace is not working for you. It's a wrong confession. Grace is working for you. When you look at your life in the eyes of the flesh, you will say grace is not working. Because in your carnal mind, you see grace only as a means to gain. You see grace only as it means to have a visa. You see grace only as it means to have a job. That is not grace. That can be the grace of your pastor, not the grace of God. The grace of God empowers a man to walk in holiness. Grace, listen to me. Ma, grace is working for me. You hear? It's working for me. Not because we built a church, because my character has changed. Grace is not working for me. So people are jumping from church to church, prophet to apostle, carrying money, putting it on their feet. I want grace to work for me. Carnal people, selfish motive. I'm sowing this seed. I want the prophetic grace. Look at carnality. Take this seed. I want the prophetic grace, so I give you money. I want the prophetic grace. It's only about us, only about things, property, dresses, cars, money, only the flesh. Romans, give me Romans 8 from verse 10 to 13. Let me show them there. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin. What is dead? But the spirit is life because of righteousness. He said your body is dead. Now see verse 11. But if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life. Alabake. He will give life to your mortal body through his spirit who dwells in you. Stop there. If Christ be in you, your body is dead. There is HIV. There is cancer. There is arthritis. Your body is dead because of sin. He said, but your spirit is life. In other words, the same time you are seeing poverty around you, sickness in your blood, is the same time there is life in your spirit. But God says, but if there is life in your spirit, if the spirit of him that raised Christ from the dead be in you, he said, it will vitalize your body. HIV will go. Cancer will go. Poverty will go. Curses will be broken. It shall come to pass on that day that the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. Do you know that Christ means anointed? Christ means anointing. Jesus, the Christ, means Jesus, the anointed one. So if Christ is in you, it means the anointing is in you. And it shall come to pass on that day that the yoke shall be destroyed because of what? No, move anointing, put Christ, because of Christ in you. Sit down, please. The body is dead because of sin. He said, but don't worry. It's the only thing you need to do. Walk after the spirit. Because the more you walk after the flesh, show me Romans 8, show me verse 13. He said, you will die. You will die. Although you have to live, you will die because you walk after the flesh. Can that skin? For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. You see, you live according to the flesh. Can desire. Desire for sex. You have sex. He said you will die. You have to walk by the spirit. So those who are conscious of Christ, next thing they have to do is to walk after the spirit. So number two, walk after. Number one is be conscious. Number two is walk after the spirit. Don't walk after the flesh. Walk after the spirit. Don't live according to the desires of your flesh. Live according to the desires of the spirit of God. I don't feel like praying. Prayer is not a feeling. Pray. That's a desire of the spirit. Your body feels like sleeping. If you live according to the desires of your body, the Bible says you will die. You know, read Bible. There is no condemnation. Wait. For those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk after the flesh. So those who are in Christ but walk after the flesh will still be seeing condemnation. So the problem is not the cause in your family. It's because you are walking in the flesh. Walking by the desires of your desires. Come on, hold yourself. Take advantage of grace and hold yourself. Resist sin with all your heart. You hear that talk, huh? With all your heart, all your might, all your power. Resist it. You see, if you live according to the flesh, you will die. HIV will kill you. Cancer will kill you. But if you live according to the spirit, even if there's HIV in your blood, you see, it will fertilize your body. Sickness will disappear. Poverty will go. Curses will be broken. Every family has a curse. I agree. that a cause only have effect on you depending where you are walking. Those who walk after the spirit cannot be under the influence of the devil, but those who walk after the flesh, no matter how they pray, the devil will oppress them, because a carnal man is enmity with God. The enemy of God is not Satan, it's a carnal man, a person who is only conscious of his body. Do not seek what you shall eat, do not seek what you shall wear, do not seek where you will live, for the pagans run after such. But ye seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything shall be added. Nowadays, all they want to hear is you will marry. What kind of message? That's the message you want to hear in church. You will marry. You will have a job. What? My God. To promote carnality. When we ought to come to the house of God and be taught the ways of God so we can walk in the spirit, we are now taught the names of new cars. You want your marriage to be fine, go to a marriage seminar. Yeah, we preach Christ. If you want to prosper your business, wait for a business seminar. When it's here, we talk about holiness and godliness. That's God's desire for you. It's about you becoming like him. You must walk after the spirit. He said, though the body is dead because of sin, the spirit is life. There is abundant life. Oh boy.
There is abundant life in Jesus.
Now, there is abundant life in you. So watch this. Your body, manda kakika, your body is dead because of sin. So you are sitting in the house, you cannot even stand up. They say you have HIV, you have cancer. But at the same time, inside your spirit is abundant life. The abundant life wants to come out. But your heart has bitterness. Your heart has unforgiveness. So abundant life is in you, but abundant life is caged. There is life in you that can kick away poverty, that can kick away sickness. But your heart worry, your heart envy, your heart jealousy, your heart bitterness, your life fornication, your life immorality. And because of that character, the spirit of God in you that want to vitalize your body cannot operate. For if you live after the flesh, you will die. When we preach and say forgive, you don't do anybody good with forgive. You do yourself good. You are still caught up in mandakisa, in little issues. God says, come on from there. There is an anointing in you that can help you. Just overcome pornography and see what will happen. Just overcome that anger you have. Just if you can overcome that weakness, listen to me. Pharaoh was not the enemy, because in Egypt they didn't die. But when they left Egypt, in the desert, they died. Because in the desert, they were faced with the weaknesses in them. Friend, they always say that the greatest demons are the ones within. The ones you think, me, I can never beat my wife. Wait till something will happen. You can never know what you can do till opportunity come. Stop talking. I can never sleep with a woman. Wait till a woman will be naked before you. We will know that day. Opportunity is the test of confession. Unless you squeeze toothpaste, you cannot know the color. Overcome that weakness. Overcome that desire. Because every time God wants to lift you, the devil brings an opportunity to sin. And if you live according to the flesh, you will die. There is a curse in my family. I agree with you, it's true. But the strength of that curse is empowered by you walking in the flesh. That anger in your heart. There is a curse in your family. You are not talking together. No matter where you go for deliverance, the curse cannot be broken, because the curse is feeding on disunity. There is a curse in your life. You cannot get married. That curse is feeding on the bitterness in your spirit. You are so bitter. So unforgiving. There is a curse in your life. You are not pursuing your business. That curse is feeding on your immorality. It is feeding on it. There is a curse in your life. You cannot pass exam. That curse is feeding on fornication. It's feeding on something. If you want to starve the curse, walk in the spirit. The curse will starve and die. If you want to feed him, walk in the flesh. Keep having anger and you are praying. Any curse in my life, you are, the more the anger grows, the more the curse increases, because he feeds on that. That is the air he breathes. Unforgiveness, bitterness, pride, the works of the flesh. Have you not read the Bible says, if you have the spirit of Christ, you are his own. I believe in God, the Father. I believe in the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus, his only son. If Jesus is the only son, you are what? Jesus, not the only son of God. Shall be not true. Jesus is not the only son of God. 1 John 3:1. Behold, what manner of love has the Father bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. John 1:12. As many as received him, he gave them the power to become sons of God. 1 John 3:2. Now we are the sons of God. Lift your hands, shout, I am a son. See that? Believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, correct. In Jesus his only son, wrong. Jesus is not the only son. Is Jesus the only son? No. Jesus, not the firstborn son of God.
His name is Jesus, the only son.
Look at that. They are worshiping, thinking they are even worshiping God.
Name is Jesus. Oh, my Redeemer Jesus. Oh, the only son.
If he's the only son, then you are still a slave to Satan. If you say that Jesus is the only son, then we have not been redeemed. Then we have not been saved. We are. Sing it for yourself. I cannot sing that song. Jesus is not the only son. I am a son of God. When Jesus arose, John 20:17, he said, Mary, do not hold on to me. Go and tell my brothers, not my servants. Go and tell my brothers, I am going to my Father, I'm your Father, to my God, I'm your God. You don't serve a dead God. You serve a mighty God. It's the same yesterday. It's the same today. It's the same forever. When God says yes, no man can say no. When God lifts you up, no man can bring you down. God is on your side. Power is on your side. Grace is on your side. God is on your side. Lift the hand, shout, I am a son. Sit down.
What is the lamb that was slain on Calvary? His name is Jesus, the only son of God. Jesus said, no, change the song. His name is Jesus, the firstborn son of God.
In the book of John, John said, he came, the only begotten of the Father. That was before Jesus died on the cross. Go and read the book of Romans. It's called the first fruit, the firstborn. So you cannot make your idea of Jesus by reading only the book of John. Read how the thing progresses. In fact, how he was called before the cross is not as valid as how he was called after the cross. Now, if I know I am a son, there is a way I should live. I must live because every son carries the nature of his father. If my father is holy, then I'm holy. If Christ be in me, then I should be an expression of him. I am a son. I am a son. It is his spirit in me that has made me a son. And sonship in Christ is not validated by material things. It's validated by the Christ-likeness of our character. How do you know sons of God? They are people that demonstrate the character of Christ. It has nothing to do with anointing. It has nothing to do with prophesying. It has everything to do with your character. How is your character? What are you expressing? Do you know that your character is a testimony of what is in you? How do we know the kind of spirit you possess? By the way you behave. A holy spirit makes a man holy. An evil spirit makes a man evil. And then he said, and this is the mystery. Christ in you, the hope of glory. There's no shame. Listen to me. Whatever you are going through now, go through it. Keep your mouth shut. Is this your complaint that is spoiling your life? Stay quiet. You don't have more problem than other people. Be quiet. Go through it. Stop making as if you are suffering more than everybody. If you go to Ethiopia, you will not talk the way you talk. You think there's war? Go to Syria and see. Stop complaining and start giving thanks in everything. He said, rejoice. And I say again, rejoice. You're not rejoicing because things look good. You are rejoicing because Christ in me, the hope. It doesn't matter the circumstances now. Hey, man of God, my son is smoking. Madam, if you can expose your son to the gospel, that child can become a prophet. Listen to me. There is nothing you have done. Stop dwelling in your past. There, hope is future. I did abortion. Leave that in the past. I did leave it in the past. He said, when Christ is present, he only deals with the future. I have made mistakes, but because Christ has come, I have hope that my future is glory and not shame. I have hope there are better days. Today may not look good, but these things will not be like this forever. You may not have a house now. Things will not be like this forever. Christ in me, the hope of glory. You may not have a job now. You may not have eaten for 1 week. Things will not be like this forever. Even though I walk through. Not though I walk through. Though I walk through. Though I walk through pain. Though I walk through sickness. I walk through affliction. Yeah, what he says. I shall fear no evil. Because I know karate, because I have a gun, for you are with me. That was David. But me, I say, for you are in me. Between me and him, which one has more strength? Though I walk through the valley of shadow, I shall fear no evil, for you are not with me, for you are in me. So whatever I face, you face. I bear the name of the Lord. I am the apple of his eye. I am the arrow in his quiver. I am the salt of his head. I am the light of his well. Everything he does is for me. He so loved me that he gave his son for me. He so needed me to come to him that he sacrificed all for me. How dare you tell me that God does not love me? How dare you tell me that you don't love me? Does your love increase me? Does your love add something to my existence? The love that I need, I already have. I have the love of God, and I'm sure that he loves me. Sometimes people may not like you, they may not love you. But no matter how good you are, not everyone can love you. God is a good God, but the devil left heaven. So sometimes, despite your goodness, your righteousness, some people will not appreciate you. See, even if you lie down for them to walk on your back, they will still complain that you are not flat enough. So sometimes you just have to live your life to please God and not to please man. For they that walk by faith, for without faith it is impossible to please God. With works you can please man, with offering you can please pastor, with sacrifice you can please a prophet, but only by faith can you please God. Christ in me. Stand on your feet.